In this video, we'll walk through the various I/O pin configuration options shown in this functional overview chart from the user's manual. This looks kind of complicated, but it's really not that bad once you understand what's going on. In this menu option, you tell pins A1 and A3 what they'll be doing. Then down here, you refine that configuration for the function that you chose. For example, if you set up pin A1 up here as an analog output, then down here, you'll be given the analog options to refine. If you set it to be a switching output, then down here you'll be able to configure what type of switching output it is. And it's the same thing for pin A3, but he can also be an error output or even an input pin. Again, you select what function in this menu and then configure it in this menu, which will be one of these options. One nice thing about all this is when you configure one of these pins, the bubble on the run mode screen changes to reflect that, so you always know what the pin is doing. If you said you want the pin to be a switching output, the bubble would be one of these A numbers. If you said you want it to be an error output, then it becomes an F for fault. If A1 is selected to be an analog output for the two sensors that can do that, then you would see an AN here for analog. So at a glance, you can see how your I/O pins are set up. I really like that. Let's use A1 for our walkthrough of all these switching and output options, since on my unit that pin has a dedicated output. In that menu, I can set the A1 output to go active when an object is detected. I just place my object in front of the laser, press T to calibrate on this object height, and whenever an object of that height goes by, the pin A1 will go active and this bubble will change. Now the signal won't go away until that object height has fallen below that level plus whatever you set the hysteresis at. That way non-uniform surfaces don't give you multiple alarms. The hysteresis is set over here. Just dial in whatever you want. This T background menu is very similar, except you learn the background and anything that's larger than a hysteresis, plus 10 millimeters, plus another half hysteresis, will be detected and the signal won't be released until it's fallen back below the hysteresis level. To set that up, you just enter the menu item, make sure there are no objects in front of the line of sight, and hit T. The sensor calibrates and you're ready to go. Now if an object passes by and is large enough, it'll be detected. This window mode is similar to the previous two, except now you can detect an object between two set points or within a window. You just place the object in the center of the region, go into the T window menu and press T. Now any object that is within this window will be detected. How wide is that window? Well, you set that right here. Just dial in anything you want. And the hysteresis, of course, is under the hysteresis menu. This POTTY command, I assume that stands for potentiometer, allows you to tweak the trigger point for all of these. For example, if your setup configured the sensor to trigger at 197 millimeters, and you need to bump that up a few millimeters, just drop into this menu and tweak it. If you have the sensor set to the teach window mode, you'll see it toggle between the two window edges like this. The plus and minus signs tweak the center of the window, so you'll see both the high and the low change each time you press one. This menu lets you set the output type. You can choose from these three options, and look, it even shows you a diagram for each one. That's pretty cool. This menu lets you pick if the output should be normally open or normally closed. The on delay and off delay menus adjust how long the sensor waits to report the start or the end of an event. You can set the time from 0 to 10 seconds. This little falling edge right here tells you that the off delay is enabled for this contact, and this one tells you that the on delay is enabled. That's really handy. Now if you chose an impulse type for the response, you can't set the output delay, and instead you'll just get an impulse like this to remind you it's not available. Speaking of impulse, the impulse menu lets you change the switching outputs to be a pulse where you specify the width. A zero width means no impulse. The signal stays active as long as the object's present. This little pulse on the main display is a reminder that this output is set to impulse mode. A minute ago we did the teach object, teach background, and teach window. With those, you set a fixed threshold, and when the object crosses that threshold, the pin changes state. That's great, but what if your application has a large temperature swing? Well, if the sensor is mounted on a large steel frame, for example, that steel frame is going to expand and contract with temperature, right? And since the resolution of these laser sensors is so fine, they're going to see that and it's going to mess up all the distances you set up. Wouldn't it be great if you could set up the sensor so that you could constantly recalibrate the sensor? Well, that's exactly what this guy does. Back under the pin function menu, I can tell pin A3 to be an external trigger for A1 and what type of mode. Then under A1's menu, I can tell it to respond to A3's trigger, and what kind of detection it should use. All the hysteresis and windowing are done using the same menus as before. The only difference is, now you have a way to automatically recalibrate the system as it runs. So if you have an application that needs to be accurate across temperature extremes, take a look at this one. It's an awesome feature. Okay, that was all the switched output modes. We have one more output to look at, the error out. If you set up a pin to be an error out, the pin will go active when the laser doesn't see any light reflected back. This can be really handy when setting up the system to ensure you have an adequate signal. Down in the pins menu, you can specify the type of output and whether it's normally open or closed. You can tell a pin it's a laser enable, which is cool because it lets you turn the laser light on or off from an external signal. The manual laser enable menu over here always wins. If you go into the menu and manually turn the laser off, this input pin will have no effect. And finally, we have the offset mode. This one has lots of uses, but let's use this as an example. Suppose you have an object that's being pushed towards a sensor, but it has an irregular shape, a protrusion like this, for example. Wouldn't it be great if we could tell the sensor to give us this answer and not the actual measured distance? Well, guess what? That's a great place to use this offset feature. You just dial in whatever offset you want, and the final distance is modified by that amount, so now you're getting the distance to this point and not to that one. With this option, your laser doesn't have to hit the nearest point of the object, and that makes your life easier because it gives you more flexibility on where you can mount the laser sensor. It doesn't have to be pointed exactly at the closest point on the object. Well, as you can see, there's a lot of things you can do with these incredibly flexible, full-featured laser distance sensors from Automation Direct. And don't forget, Automation Direct's tech support is free, and you'll talk to a real live person here in the US within minutes. Got a question? You can call, email, or even do online chat during regular business hours. Automation Direct offers Wenglor distance measuring sensors from 80 micrometers all the way out to 100 meters to cover all of your distance measuring needs.